Hello everyone, my name is Sezen de Bruin. I'm a solution architect at OutSystems and I have been a pre-sales before in the testing area at HP. And today I'm going to tell you a little bit about quality assurance in OutSystems, specifically about the usage of BDD framework and unit testing and the place they have with it, quality assurance with OutSystems. OutSystems thinks that quality assurance is actually quite simple in big lines, but very hard to execute upon. So what are the three pillars of a good quality assurance strategy? The first one is pretty simple, it's prevention. Any quality issues that you don't have are issues that are easily solved because you don't have to do anything about them. So OutSystems has several things to help you with preventing quality issues. These are the things that are built into the OutSystems technology, such as the fact that we test our code upfront for performance issues, technical issues, security issues, making sure that you don't have to do the lowest level of unit testing and validation. Now, this is important to keep in mind because this will tie in with our BDD unit testing later on. All right, so after prevention, we have monitoring. No matter how hard you prevent things, things tend to sneak in anyway. So we want to catch them in the act and basically fix them before they become big issues and accumulate over time. So in terms of doing that, we have a lot of different tools at our disposal in OutSystems as well. You're aware of OutSystems performance analytics, but also, for instance, Architecture Dashboard really fits in this strategy. Architecture Dashboard does several things for you in that area. It shows you how things tie together. Therefore, also shows you what the more risky parts of your application solution are that a lot of things depend on, so that you can do focused and targeted testing in those risky areas. But it also shows you, for instance, places where best practices might be violated, and therefore there's a bigger risk of quality issues overall. So monitoring is a very important aspect of any quality assurance strategy, and we recommend you do this as part of your sprints and as part of your release, and you can take various approaches to that. Of course, finding issues is only a sensible action if you actually then address them. So the third part of our quality assurance strategy is refactoring. Refactoring can be done in various ways. The most preferable way is probably that, you know, in an ideal world, whenever you bring something to a release or close a sprint, you have a green dashboard on all of your different monitoring layers. So this is called an all-green development approach, and that's wonderful. In practice, we see, however, that people tend to sometimes be pressured through deadlines and other issues, which means that they sometimes need to rush things into production anyway. So in those cases, it's very important for you to be able to address those issues head on and take the time as a team to do a refactoring sprint. Just to make sure that if something did creep in, you do take the time to address it. So this is your overall quality assurance strategy. But where then do tests fit into all of this? Why should we even test at all if we already have prevention methods and monitoring methods? Well, that's because OutSystems cannot do everything for you. We try to, and don't get us wrong, if we could do everything for you, we would. But the one thing we can do is read your mind. So where we are able to see if something is technically correct or if something is very performant, we are not quite able to see if it is functionally what you meant it to be. So functionality still needs to be tested by you. You are the only one who can write tests for that. So where do tests fit into our technology? Where do they fit into the OutSystems quality assurance approach? Basically on all of the different levels. So in terms of prevention, we want to prevent building things that don't functionally match what we designed it to be. So we do still need some higher level unit testing, which is very much focused on the functionality. And that is why we use the BDD framework for these types of unit tests, which is quite unusual in testing approaches because BDD application testing is usually done on a slightly higher level. But because low-code is already validating the lower parts in unit testing, the technical parts, you need to only focus on that higher level of the unit testing pyramid. Then a second place where your BDD tests fit in is in your monitoring approach. Because of course you want to not just monitor if things are architecturally correct, if your best practices are being followed, and if the performance is still good, you also want to monitor if your functionality stays up to standard. This is what we call regression tests, and part of your regression test can also be a set of BDD tests that are perhaps the same ones, or at least partially the same ones, as the ones that you use in the prevention aspect of this strategy as well. So this is where the BDD framework will fit into your general quality assurance approach. And I think now is a good time for you to see what this BDD framework actually is. Now, because you are an OutSystems developer, and you know your way around, and you know kind of what BDD is, I'm not going to spend so much time explaining the basics to you. I'm just going to assume you understand all of this, and we're going to jump right into a demo. The demo I'm going to do today is quite nice. We're going to look at a data-driven test. That is to say, we have a set of different rows in a Excel sheet that have the test data that we want to run our application through. And we have a piece of logic that we want to test with this data. Now, one approach could of course be that I'm going to manually now enter all of this data into the system through a screen that I've just created for this purpose to see if the right outcomes come out. This is lame. We're not going to do that. We're going to automate that. And that's where the BDD framework comes in.
I'm going to be creating a BDD test for you for today. In order to do that, I'm going to start from scratch, use a traditional web application because we'll be using the BDD testing framework. And within this test application that I've created, I'm going to make a specific test module for my vaccination program, which is the piece of logic that we're going to be testing, and I'm going to create the module. Now, what we're going to be building today is a data-driven test, which means that we're going to basically import a set of test data into the application in order to enable the test that we need to execute. So what I'm going to do is to grab the vaccine test data and drag that into my application. This is going to create a bootstrap action, which I'm going to alter to import my test data. So in order to do that, I'm going to go to my bootstrap action, which has been automatically created by my dragging and dropping of the Excel sheet. And I'm going to delete the get vaccines and all of that nonsense, and also all of this nonsense, because really I don't want to put any of this data into the database. I have a different method. I can actually also delete this vaccine data table because I don't need it. And it's just going to take up space in our database, which means we also delete this local variable. So if I'm not going to use any of the standard things, what is then the use of this bootstrap action? Well, we're going to instead give a test data as an output and create a list of the Excel vaccine test data. So really these things have been created just by the dragging and dropping. So that's basically created this Excel sheet, it uploaded it in resources, and it created this structure, which I'm now using as an output. I'm going to assign the Excel data into the output parameter. And now we have basically the preparation for our test data set. What I'm going to do now is create a test. And in order to do that, I'm going to use a template from the BDD testing framework. In this case, I'm using the data-driven scenario. So this is the screen that is generated. Of course, first things first, we're going to utilize that test data action that we've just generated to bootstrap the vaccines into the screen. So we just pull in the bootstrap action, and then we're going to give it an assign. And we're going to assign it into the data parameter list that we get standard from this template. Now, as you can see, this is not going to match because the data that we get from the bootstrap vaccine action is actually structured, that is to say it has four data parameters, whereas the one that we get here from the screen is a text list. So first thing we're going to do is set this list to be equal to the structure that we have just created. There it is, the Excel test data. So that resolves one error, but it gives us another one because in this screen, we have a list of this specific weblog. So for each row that we're going to get from the Excel sheet, we're going to have a visualization of that weblog with the data parameters that we're passing on. And that data that we're passing on is going to be the data parameter list that we have here, but the input it expects is, of course, also a text. So we also need to switch this one to the example test data. All right, so we now have created the entire infrastructure for the data script part of this. We have basically fetched the data from the Excel, we have prepared it, we have listed it out on the screen. Now we need to quickly implement this scenario a little bit further. So first thing we're going to do is going to write out our behavior-driven scenario. First thing we're going to do is we're going to basically describe the data that we receive. So given a stock of, and then we'll just add the stock in data parameter. And shipment of, we'll add the amount of cents that we receive. Of course, always add pluses in between so that we can easily string them together. Buck cents. So that's our given step. So this is what we start off. Given a specific stock in and a specific shipment. And then the next point is when we distribute the buck cents, that's the action that we're going to take. We expect to see a certain amount of people drafted. So let's just add the test number of that being drafted plus and leftover stock of, and we're going to add there the stock out here. All right, so with that, we basically have a given when then scenario, and now we need to automate all of those. So I'm going to add a given assert to check if the data that we're starting with makes sense. And the way that we do this is we going to import from the BDD framework the assert steps. So the BDD framework is here, and we would like to have the assert steps to work with. Let's use a assert false. So this one is only going to assert a false, and then we're going to say invalid inputs. And then we'll just create a condition in which case we would like to see this. And that would be if this stock in is less than zero, because that would not make sense, right? You cannot have a negative stock. Or if the vaccine amount is less than or equal to zero. All right, so that's just to check if we have the right data to start this test with. Then we're going to do a when step. And in this when step, we're going to execute the action on the test, which in this case is the vaccination program. Calculate the vaccines and stop. All right, so in order to do that, we're going to grab that action. We're gonna put the test data into it. And then we need to save the results. So we're going to create two local variables. The first one we'll call stock out, and the second one we're going to call drafty number. Now the number one is immediately jumping to integer. The stock out is not, so let me just correct myself. And let's save the outcomes of this test here. All right, so the stock out is equal to data parameter one, stock out. Nope. To that is the test data. to the calculate vaccines and stock out. And the drafty number is this one. All right, then we're going to go to the done step, which is where we're going to do the final assert. So I'm going to just add an assert here that is the expected stock out, which is the one that we get from the test data. And what is the actual thing stuck out? That's the one that we're saving here. And I'll do a second assert, which is the actual drafty number that we expect based on the test data. And then we'll have the actual thing value here as well. Let me now publish this. And then we're going to show you quickly what we've built. So we've built this automated test here, right? Where we can read quite easily given when, then, what basically the starting scenario stage of the test, what happens as part of the action on the test, and then what the outcome should be, the data that we'd like to verify. And we use this input parameter with the test data to fail out the details for this test. And because we've set it up in this way, we can now in the vaccination program loop over the test data that we have received out of the Excel sheet and iterate over it and execute basically each scenario, the scenario for each of the set of test data. So now I can basically run this test using a lot of different sets of data. And as you can see, we now see that given a stock of one, a shipment of seven vaccines, we distribute the vaccines, and we have four people drafted. So that's eight vaccines in this group because each person gets two, and we have zero left over. And then you see here we have a failed test. I built this one in deliberately because here we have one in stock, 112 vaccines being shipped. So we have 113 vaccines. It's correct that 56 people would then be drafted, but there would be a leftover stock of zero. And it says here, we expected zero, but obtained one, which makes sense because in this case, the test data is wrong. And as you can see, I've now executed this test over a large set of data. And this is how BDD testing can help you more efficiently test.
So hopefully that demonstration showed you that next to just being generally good quality assurance practices, BDD tests can also help you as a developer to easily validate your functionality in a way that you sometimes cannot really do in a manual method. So it's not just good for your organization or testing in general, it's good for you. And I think that that's an important takeaway to take from this session as well. All right, so if we are going to BDD test, we should probably also know a little bit about best practices. So let me share a little with you today. I've cherry-picked some of the best practices that I've asked my colleagues about in OutSystems in the more quality assurance related fields of OutSystems. And I've just collected a very few best of them for you. So a first thing to keep in mind when you're doing your test is that you should definitely not combine them with your application. It's very tantalizing, right, to include a test module into your application, because then you have your test neatly with your application and you easily can put them together into the next environment. The one reason why you should not do it is that you inevitably will then take them with you to production. You don't want to have your tests in production, so you should not have them in the same application. What you should do instead is have either one application where you keep all of your different tests, or keep them as separate test applications that can easily be deployed. Now, the latter one is probably the most sensible approach, because you can then easily only deploy the tests that need to go along with your specific application, which is very convenient, especially if you do things like CI/CD and a more automated approach there. It's not necessarily a problem if you need to also bring some other tests along each time you do a deployment, but it is not optimal. So my recommendation would be keep them in a separate test application per application. And in terms of naming conventions, a test module is usually tagged with the application name, as the so the name of the application that's under test, and then underscore test, so that you can easily match them together. All right, second best practice. You should not keep your data preparation in the same module as the test that you are running with. It seems very sensible to keep your data preparation into the module, and I in fact did this wrong in the demo, right? Because in the demo I did do the data preparation in the same module as I did the test, but that was for demo purposes. I expect you to be better than me. So how you will be better than me is by keeping a separate module for your data preparation. The reason for that is that in order to do your data preparation, you are going to need usually some files with your data in it, such as your Excel sheets, which you tend to store on the resources in the module where you do your data preparation. These types of assets can really start slowing down your publish. So if you click on the one-click publish button, it will become slow to submit these new versions of this application. So to avoid slowing down your testing and your agility of your testing, you should keep this in a separate module to make it easy for people to create new versions of tests without slowing the process down. So separate your data preparation away from the actual test that you're executing. Then the third best practice that I definitely recommend. Tests, you don't do them for funsies, right? You do them to quickly see issues and find them. So tests should be designed with an eye towards root cause analysis. You want to be able to see if an automatic test fails immediately which functionality it is concerning. Now, that is of course why we give the scenarios a name, an identifier. Our systems, we use a practice where we actually have a letter code at the beginning that indicates first with the first letters what the application name is, and then with the further letters basically what the specific functionality is that is being tested. That way you can easily see, oh, I have a lot of crosses all concerning this specific functionality, maybe something is going wrong. So this is our third best practice. Use a scenario identifier that will help you speed up your root cause analysis. A fourth best practice is concerning the way that you set up your testing scenarios. Because what you want to do is you want to have a way where you can test an entire functionality within one go. So rather than making a test per scenario per screen, you're going to make a test scenario in a web block. That web block is then an isolated test scenario, and you can have multiple of these test scenarios into one screen, so that rather than having to go and run multiple screens in order to test one specific functionality, I have only one screen that I should open to see all of the tests concerning that specific functionality, so that I very quickly can see if something is wrong with that specific functionality. So test scenarios into web blocks, test functionality under test per screen. This brings us to our final best practice, reusability. The place where all tests fail is that eventually they're going to break because the functionality they're testing is changed. And this is all right, right? You have a test, it fails, you adapt the test to fit the new version of the functionality, and everything is well and good. But in practice, we see that a lot of situations, people don't tend to do the maintenance on the test that they have created. So what they wind up with is either a lot of tests that continuously fail, and therefore they start disregarding the results, or even better at least, they just delete the tests out of the set, but then you have a part of functionality that sort of falls out of the scope of your testing. So in order to avoid that, you do need to maintain your tests, which means that you need to build them for maintenance. So how do you do this? The best way is to make sure that you take the same approach as you do with any form of programming within OutSystems, any form of coding, which is to set it up in a reusable fashion. So rather than doing the data setup for each test separately, you should try to see if there might be multiple tests that can use this type of data setup, set it up in a more generic reusable fashion, and make sure that there's only one place where this functionality is, so that when the data that you're using in that specific functionality, for instance, changes, you can easily adapt that one specific reusable asset rather than having to go back and change 20 different tests, because the likelihood that you will change one thing is a lot bigger than the likelihood that you will change 20 things. All right, well, this was all of the things that I could tell you about BDD testing in such a short frame of time. I hope it was interesting to you. There's one small final announcement that I get to make. Of course, on OutSystems side, we are working on the BDD framework quite hard. And one of the things that we have been doing in the past few months is work on a client-side testing capability for the mobile and reactive parts. This version will be released somewhere this summer, as well will there be a version with a slightly improved approach towards server-side testing. So there's just a lot of fun stuff happening in the BDD framework area. It's something that OutSystems is focusing on, and I would definitely make sure that you keep track on the new things that are coming out. So I imagine that after all of that, you probably have some questions, or if you don't, I would be very disappointed in you. So please do ask them to me. Now, unfortunately, you're watching this at any time in the future. I can't talk with you, so I do need to give you just a place for you to reach me, which can be either on LinkedIn or on my email address, and you'll find both of them here in the screen somewhere.